Good evening. Calling our board meeting of the Tangipahoa Parish School System to order for February 28, 2023. Roll call, Ms. Cindy.
Ms. Richards?
Present.
Mr. Toler?
Present.
Ms. Abrams?
Here.
Mr. Westmoreland?
Present.
Mr. Duncan?
Here.
Mr. Anthony?
Here.
Mr. Moore?
Here.
Mr. Piazza?
Here.
Ms. Dominguez?
Present.
Okay. First item on our agenda is the Pledge of Allegiance, and I'm asking that Mr. Jerry Moore would lead us in the pledge.
Pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Moore. At this time for our patriotic song, we will have none other than our own multiple Billboard chart-topping recording artist and songwriter, Mr. Titus Showers. He is a two-time Stella Award nomination, two number one gospel albums, number one radio single, and five top 30 songs. On YouTube, he has eclipsed 1 million views, and he's rocked national TV appearances such as the 2021 Presidential Inauguration Gospel Celebration, BET's 2020 Stella Awards. None other than our own Tangipahoa Parish citizen, Mr. Titus Showers.
It's on.
It should be on.
It's on now. It's on now. Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that our dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies, and let us march on till victory is won.
At this time, I had the honor of attending the Black History program up at O.W. Dillon Leadership Academy. And since that this is Black History Month, and the purpose of Black History Month is a month-long focus on the Black heroes and pioneers who have shaped our world. More than that, it is the spotlight, the importance of being an ally to marginalized communities, not just 28 days, but for all 365 days in the year. Is it a time to acknowledge and celebrate the contributions made by Black heroes throughout our communities, our history, and our nation. At this time, we will have a Black History Moment performed by O.W. Dillon.
You may write me down in history with your bitter. You may write me down in history with your bitter twisted lies. You may tread me in the very dirt, but still like dust I'll rise.
Does my sadness upset you? Why are you beset with gloom? 'Cause I walk like I got oil wells pumping in my living room.
Just like moons and like suns, with a certainty of tides. Just like hope springing high, still I rise.
Did you want to see me broken? Bowed head and lowered eyes, shoulders falling down like teardrops, weakened by my soulful cries.
Does my hopiness offend you? Don't you take it awful hard, 'cause I laugh like I got gold mines digging in my own backyard.
You may shoot me with your words, you may cut me with your eyes, you may kill me with your hatefulness, but still like air, I rise.
Out of the huts of history's shame, I rise. Up from a past rooted in pain, I rise.
I'm a black ocean, leaping and wide, welling and swelling, I bear in the tide. Leaving behind nights, terror and fear, I rise.
Into a daybreak that's so wondrously clear, I rise, bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave. I am the dream and the hope of the slave.
Maya Angelou.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be Look at it.
That was their modified version. Thank you. Thank you, O.W. Dillon.
Madam President, I do have a motion at this time. Ask that we waive the rules and add an agenda item under superintendent's reports and recommendations to receive a report and recommendation on drainage and facility improvement needs at Kentwood and Sumner High Schools.
Second.
And this is a motion that will need unanimous consent.
Voting is open. Oh, wait a minute. Go ahead. Vote, it's open. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Okay. Item E, consider approval of board minutes of February the 7th, 2023.
Move to adopt.
Second.
It's been moved to adopt by Ms. Westmoreland and Mr. Anthony.
Yeah.
Okay. Ms. Piazza. Okay, thank you. Any questions? Call for a vote, Ms. Cindy.
Voting is open. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Okay. At this time for awards and recognitions, we're going to do just a little switch up. We will have item A to recognize Mr. Titus Showers Sr. and Ms. Regina Showers Garten for receiving the Lifetime Achievement Award from the President Joe Biden. Then we will have item B, which will be the Sicilian, which was 6A, Ms. Cindy. And then we will have recognition of Ms. Robin Price as SLU Lab Schools Teacher of the Year.
I'd like to present you with this recognition and appreciation. This is from the Certificate of Recognition to Mr. Titus Shower, Sr. Chancellor Parish School Board would like to express its admiration for your service to the community and your outstanding leadership, and also receiving the Lifetime Achievement Award from President Joe Biden. And it's signed on this 28th day of February by the superintendent, myself, and Ms. Janice Richards, the board president.
Wow.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
We appreciate it.
Thanks so much.
And this is for
some kickball with us.
Absolutely. You guys are awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. At this time, we would like to recognize the Independent Sicilian Heritage Festival, which will be held next weekend in Independence. If I could have Mr. Jinko, if he would come and read the proclamation for us.
Yes, thanks. Make Mr. Larry read it.
I would like to say that we have had a festival in Independence for the last 50 years. This actually in 2023 makes exactly 50 years that we've had a festival of some kind in the town of Independence. 15 years ago, the Independent Sicilian Heritage Festival was formed, and we've been going strong since 2009. We have a small board. There's only about 30 of us. Mr. Jinko is now on our board. He is a past king, and we have some of our board members and past royalty here as well. But I'm going to let Mr. Jinko go ahead and read the proclamation.
Thank you, Ms. Robin. It says, whereas Sicilian heritage is rich, entwined in the history of the United States, Sicilians and individuals of Sicilian descent have made remarkable contributions to the development of this country through exploration, science, literature, business, and government. And whereas in September 1888, the citizens of Independence donated land for a school and elected trustees to supervise the operations of the school. And whereas in the 1800s and the 1890s, many Sicilian families arrived in Tangipahoa Parish. And whereas these hardworking families, mostly from Sicily, profoundly affected the character of the town of Independence. And whereas the town of Independence celebrates the rich Sicilian heritage with an annual Sicilian Heritage Festival in March. And therefore be it resolved that the Tangipahoa Parish School Board joins with all residents of Sicilian American descent to celebrate the 2023 Sicilian Heritage Festival in Independence, Louisiana on the second weekend in March.
Okay, we need a motion.
Motion made.
Motion by Mr. Toler.
Second.
Second by Mr. Piazza.
I think my last name kind of required.
I think.
Letting y'all know.
Any questions, comments?
You want to introduce the ones that are here, Robin?
Yes. If I we'll go ahead and do a vote.
Voting is open.
It's you.
Yes, Ms. Cindy, it's not popping up on mine either.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Is at this time I would like to bring the members of our Sicilian Festival Board and Cultural Museum forward. We have with us members of our board, but mostly importantly, our King Mayor, as we call him, Mr. Jim Payne. He is the Mayor of Independence and also the 2023 Independent Sicilian Heritage Festival King. We have Mr. Donnie Orlando, who is our over our museum in Independence. Ms. Jeanette Patnella, who is on, has been on our boards for 15 years. Ms. Lisa Payne, who is our 2023 Chairman this year, also the First Lady. We have Mr. Larry Cardinella, who was our King 2 years ago, and he's been on our board since 2009 as well. And we have Mr. Reggie Martin, who was our very first chairman in 2009. But I would like for, oh, I forgot about Mr. Ron sitting over there. He joined our board last year, but he was our 2021 King as well. I'm going to have our mayor say a few words and invite you all to our festival.
Thank y'all for joining us tonight and passing this proclamation for us. Our festival is March 10th through the 12th. We invite all y'all out. It'll be a good weekend, good food, good fun, and good music. Please come out and join us.
We're going to try in the next few years to start bringing literature to all of our schools in Independence and letting them know what the Sicilian Heritage Festival is all about, because all of our ancestors settled there in Independence many, many years ago, including my own family. My mom still lives on the land that my grandfather worked so hard for as a strawberry farmer. So we're going to start giving literature to our children in Independence to let them know exactly how our land came to be in Independence and what we've done to make that town the way what it is today. And we're going to invite all of you to come out to our festival this next weekend. We do have the spaghetti cook-off, which Ms. Jeanette is in charge of, this coming Saturday. If you would like to taste some great spaghetti, come on out on March the 4th in downtown Independence. Guarantee you'll have a good time.
Oh, let me get a picture. I'm so sorry. Yes.
Yeah.
Good.
That'd be awesome.
You really want to see him squirm. Ask him if it's sweet gravy or is it regular gravy. That's which one's better. You got sweet. That's your opinion. Hot bread. Stop. I haven't eaten all day, man. Don't stop me. Starving. Eating alone. Right. You know what I had for lunch today? Pineapple. Pineapple and grape. Are you going to this?
Thank you, Mary.
How? I don't know. Well, she's from LaRonja. She's from LaRonja, guys.
Okay. At this time, we're going to recognize Ms. Robin Price as SLU Lab School Teacher of the Year. Ms. Sharon Spring? Oh, well.
Ms. Spring. I would like to ask Ms. Stilley and Ms. Richards to come back down, if you don't mind. Though. So let me turn this back around, because Ms. Price is shy. She was supposed to be sitting right here, and she sat in the back. But it's my great honor and pleasure, I'm going to make her speak to you, to recognize Ms. Robin Price as the SLU Labs Teacher of the Year winner. But there's a reason she wasn't here when we did our other Teacher of the Year recipients, and I would like her to share with you, because it is a great reason she wasn't here, and they actually have an announcement about winning.
So we were at Beta for Louisiana, and we actually won, my robotics team won fourth. So we get to compete for nationals, and I believe we won like seven placements. So we have a big team trying to go to nationals in June, so we're looking for sponsors. But thank you for allowing me to pose later.
Thank you.
Thank you for recognizing her tonight.
I'd like to recognize her dad, and I guess that maybe her husband present with you.
They're giving you a workout today, Mr. Jenkins. That's right. Don't have to do cardio.
Okay, next on our agenda is the presentations. Presentation of the 21-22 Annual Comprehensive Financial Report by John Murray, CPA, Director of Audit and Assurance Services. Mr. Jeff.
I was just going to introduce Mr. Murray.
So we performed the audit for the year ended June 30th, 2022, and y'all have the comprehensive financial report. And so this is some information taken from that. So I'll just go through some highlights. If you have any questions, just please let me know. Go to the next page there. The first thing would be go over the audit results, kind of give you a breakdown of the financial statements.
It'd help if I put this in.
So for governmental entities, there's two different sets of financial statements. There's the government-wide financial statements, which is full accrual, includes all y'all's capital assets, and also includes debt and your long-term liabilities. And then you have the fund-basis financial statement, which is what y'all budget off of during the year. For the government-wide financial statements, we had a net position of negative $251.6 million at June 30th. Now, it sounds like a very large amount, but the GASB requires that y'all record the present value of y'all's retiree health insurance and your net pension liability for your employees on a present value basis. So that's really, really why that number is that large. The retiree insurance accounts for $250 million of that, and the pension accounts for about $119 million of that. They had a positive change in net position of $70.7 million for the year. And we also implemented GASB 87. Previously, leases, you pretty much just paid them as you expensed them as you paid them. But now the GASB requires us to record a right of use asset and a liability and amortize that. That was a net decrease of about 8,000 in net position. To kind of go over the governmental fund financial statements, these are all the governmental funds combined. You had a total fund balance of $133 million. You had revenues of $308 million. And expenditures of $265.6 million. You can go to the next page. To focus on the general fund, the general fund had a fund balance of $21.7 million at June 30th. Of that, about $10.5 million is unassigned or unrestricted. The general fund had a positive change in fund balance of $3.8 million, had revenues of $170.2 million, and expenditures of $169.6 million. And also had transfers in of $3.2 million. Kind of go over some significant events and changes for this year. We kind of talked about the GASB lease standard that we implemented. But then the other big thing was the Hurricane Ida, the recovery, and the impact of that. And so one of the things we had to do is we had to look at y'all's assets, capital assets, and see how they had been damaged by the hurricane and record an impairment. So we record an impairment loss of $7.1 million for the year. That was offset because y'all had insurance proceeds of $24.4 million. Of course, y'all were in the process of, you know, rebuilding, you know, repairing all those buildings and so forth. We performed our audit in accordance with generally accepted auditing standards and governmental auditing standards. And the results of our audit was we gave an unmodified or clean opinion on y'all's financial statements for the year. As part of the audit, we also have to issue a couple of other reports. The first one of those being the Government Audited Standards Report required by the GAO. And on that report, we have to obtain an understanding of y'all's internal control. We have to do certain testing and walkthroughs of y'all's controls to see if those controls are in place. And we also test y'all's compliance with state laws and y'all's bond covenants. And so we did have one finding related to the internal control, and that is titled 22-001, Inadequate Monitoring of Contract. And that related to one of y'all's contracts for debris removal and hurricane remediation. We looked at the testing for that, and there was a cover sheet, but there wasn't like the documentation you would need to see which school was worked on and see what subcontractor was paid and so forth. And so our recommendation on that was that y'all improve y'all's policies and procedures over the monitoring of those contracts. And you may even want to hire a consultant or have somebody in-house, you know, be charged with monitoring those contracts to make sure that they, are being performed as per the contract. As for non-compliance, we did have one instance of non-compliance. Louisiana state law requires everybody, board member, employee, to obtain an annual ethics training, 1 hour ethics training. And so the five employees that we tested, we noted that they did not take the training during 2022. So our recommendation on that is y'all ensure that, you know, employees, everybody, you know, takes the ethics training in the future. The other report we have to issue is related to y'all's federal programs. Y'all will have to have a single audit, and so basically we test y'all's compliance with the federal programs. And this year we tested Title I, ESSER, and Early Childhood Block Grant. And the results of that was we identified no material weaknesses or significant deficiencies related to y'all's controls over client compliance. And we gave an unmodified opinion on y'all's financial statements or on the compliance for the year. So it was a clean opinion on y'all's compliance. In addition, there's some things that we're required to communicate to the board. We talked about new accounting standards that were adopted, the existing policies, there were no changes this year. Our financial statements include certain significant sensitive estimates. Those include y'all's useful life of the capital assets, net pension liability, OPEB liability, and claims liability. And that's part of, you know, preparing the financial statements. We didn't have any difficulties in the audit. We did have some journal entries, which we've provided to finance, but there were no uncorrected misstatements or no material corrected misstatements for the year. We also did not have any disagreements in other findings or issues. Finally, as part of the audit, we're required to perform agreed upon procedures. There's two different sets of those. One relates to y'all's performance statistical data that y'all remit to the Department of Education. And that covers about four different areas. Your Schedule I, general fund instructional and support expenses, your class size characteristics, and your public school staff, education level experience, and public school staff data. In our testing of that, we only noted a couple of exceptions. There were a couple of teachers which had differences in the salary amount in which y'all remitted to the Department of Ed. Finally, the legislative auditor requires statewide agreed upon procedures. These are 14 areas of controls and compliance best practices that the legislative auditor has identified that all governments should have. And so we performed that testing. We only had exceptions in 10 of the on four of the 14 sections. There was one related to one bank reconciliation which was not prepared within 2 months of the statement date. We noticed that some of y'all's school activities funds did not have documentation of the receipts or collection documentation, so it was not, we could not determine whether it had been deposited within 1 day. That's one of the legislative arch's best practices. And then we talked about the ethics. And then finally, this year, one of the new requirements was sexual harassment. There's a policy that's required to be on y'all's website. And also, there's a required report which has to be done by February 1st of each year. And we noted y'all did the report, but it wasn't done by that time. And it's not something that you have to submit it to anybody. It's basically just something you have to have on hand if somebody asks for it. So that was all I had. Do you have any questions?
Okay. On the, I guess, page 6 or whatever, the inadequate monitoring of contract, I went back and looked at that on page 211 and 212. Can you give us some more insight of what are we referring to, and what amounts are we talking about?
Well, the payment in question was for about $2.3 million. And really, you know, anytime you have a construction pay application. You know, basically there's an architect that certifies it. And then there also there's all this supporting documentation that shows like who was paid, you know, what project was, you know, this part of it, we're 20% done, so we're getting paid this amount. And so we just saw that it was for that one payment that was the cover sheet, and we really would need to see additional support for that.
So how deep do y'all get into that to try to figure out what happened?
Well, we did conduct inquiries, you know, of the contractor to see if, and they provided some information as well, but it still wasn't really kind of, you know, what you would need, you know, to really see that, you know. And of course, we're auditors, so we're looking at it after the fact, and really, you know, it's kind of, I mean, the big thing is, as you're monitoring, is it just y'all monitoring to make sure that, you know, the work is being done.
So,
So was this the contract to Anzalone Construction?
Yes, sir.
Who we actually did hire on an emergency basis to be the monitor for our IDA recovery program. And was this payment for the initial phase of his monitoring services, or what was it? Because it was interesting to me that the recommendation was that we hire a monitor for these emergency services that were provided, and it was for a payment that was to the person that we hired to monitor the contracts on these emergency services that we authorized.
Well, the contract we were looking at was actually work that was being done, you know, like debris removal, you know, basically, you know, everything you would have to do was, you know, related, you know, to the hurricane recovery and so forth.
Okay.
And so really, just kind of really would like, you know, to see a little bit more support as far as what work was.
Do you know when y'all were asking for clarification on this, were you ever able to talk to the folks that were actually in charge at the time to see if they had an adequate explanation, like our chief financial officer that was in charge back then, or the budget lady that's since retired?
We did. So we talked to the contractor, and they provided us some information. And then we also talked to, you know, Director of Business Affairs, and they provided us additional information. But again, it was kind of just a summary level, and it really didn't have a whole lot of detail.
And it ultimately, it didn't result in us having an unclean audit. We still ended up with an unqualified.
Yeah, we basically kind of looked at it, and it was, I mean, it everything, you know, looked like it was, you know, it was an expenditure that, you know, y'all had to make. So it wasn't something where we could question the expenditure. We're just bringing it to you as from a control standpoint, just making a recommendation.
Making more documentation.
Yes, sir.
And I think that's where I was going with this, because I think now we're in a better position with better personnel in place to oversee some of these things. But if I'm not mistaken, this is probably the first pay app of probably many to come from this same deal, and if documentation is missing on the first one, documentation hopefully will not be missing on the second or the third one to justify what we spent. You know, we all understand the fact that things are done at emergency time, but there's still documentations that have to back up what we spend. So what's the next step in that part to clear up any clarification on this? Where do we go with this to make sure that we get the documentation in place?
I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I mean, I would think just really, I would kind of look at it on a prospective basis, just making sure that in the future, you know, that is, you know, that monitoring is happening. But as far as like, you know, what additional has to happen, I'm not sure about that. So, I mean, whatever y'all would think
on that.
That's
all I have.
So back to what Brett said. So basically we hired as an emergency replacement the Anzalone Construction Company to monitor it, but now we're saying that the monitor didn't write down exactly what we spent the money on. That's what I got. But we did hire somebody to monitor somebody. But we only had, like you said, we've got a lot more employees in place now where we didn't at that time. We were very shorthanded at that time. So, and we had millions and millions of dollars worth of IDA construction on every campus.
And so we test this, you know, for a lot of parishes and cities and so forth. And one of the things that's usually required is, you know, there's like a contract for like the, you know, the actual contract, but then there's a monitoring contract, somebody that's, you know, monitoring to make sure that that's being done. So that's kind of what the basis of our recommendation on that.
Okay.
To monitor somebody.
So,
I mean,
one question. So then who would be qualified to serve as that that monitoring?
I would think it, you know, I mean, I would think, I mean, I know there's a lot of companies that that's all they do is just monitor those contracts. So, you know, I mean, I would think probably.
So it wouldn't be any monitoring company specific?
Right. Or even an architect or somebody that, you know, that's knowledgeable of those contracts and the performance of that work. And again, it could, you know, it could be something that you do internal. I mean, it doesn't have to be external. It could be something that's done internal if you have somebody.
Well, actually, can I finish?
Yeah.
Actually, we hired somebody, and then he wasn't monitoring, and he wasn't hired anymore. So we did take care of it, actually. So.
Yep. I do want to clarify, there were two contracts. There was one contract that was as a program manager, kind of what you're talking about, to monitor everything that was going on. This was more of a contract as a general contractor that was actually hiring subs to go out and put temporary roofs on buildings, to remove trees, to do mitigation with the school. So the contract that they're referring to, mm-hmm. is the second one that had to do with actual work being done. And I think what he's saying is that work needed to have additional monitoring. In particular, FEMA requires, if you're removing trees and stumps and that kind of stuff, you have to have someone there to GPS it, and it's just some additional monitoring that we will certainly have in place.
But Mr. McNeely, as I recall, or at least I thought, that when we did the emergency authorization for this administration to do all of this, because again, it was a lot, and we were very shorthanded in that department at the time. I think we were between various people that, mm-hmm. were in, I mean, we were basically asking our CFO at the time to wear like six different hats, and I'm not exaggerating. But I thought that we, in addition to hiring Anzalone to help manage some of the construction, we did hire a FEMA consulting firm to come in and also provide us with services consulting on how to maximize our FEMA dollars.
We have a contract with a firm that is helping us go capture FEMA dollars, but there weren't actually boots on the ground taking pictures and GPS and
then that was in addition to insurance adjusters that were also right. here. I mean, we had a lot of people, and it was a lot to manage, and we again had a very skeleton crew at the time, which is we've since addressed. We definitely don't,
right.
I wouldn't describe what we have now as a skeleton crew.
And to answer your question, before we make the additional payments, we are reviewing the contract, and we're reviewing everything that's being submitted. Terry and Mr. Jules Lagarde are going through everything to make sure that we have the documentation we have, so we won't have a repeat finding on this same contract.
That's where I was going with it. Thank you.
And let's hope we don't have any more hurricanes to have to worry about repeat
sure.
contracts.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Ms. McMahon.
That's a lot dealing with FEMA.
Okay, thank you. Item B, presentation by Extended School Services, ESS. Mr. Jinko.
Good evening, everyone. We are at the end of our contract with ESS, our subsystem company. They'd like to do a presentation before you consider the renewal or non-renewal.
Hi, good evening. My name is Mike DeMarco. I definitely could participate in the Sicilian Festival that we were talking about earlier. So I appreciate everyone having us here tonight to be able to present. I head up the South Central area of the United States for ESS. And I have with me tonight Becky Saffels, who's our VP of Operations for Louisiana, as well as Clarissa Quinn, who is our on-site account manager for the district. So I'm going to hand it over to Becky and Clarissa, and they're going to go through some of our statistics. Thanks.
Thank you all for having us. And I know that Mr. Jinko shared our mid-year review, I believe, with everyone this past week. I just kind of summarized some of our highlights and different things and then to go over. So as you can see here, from our previous school year to this current year, we pulled the August through February data, so it's more current. So it's up through just last week. We filled a little over 5,000 more positions this school year than we did last year, with over 1,500 of those positions being in the Southside area specifically, because I do know that that is one of our biggest areas of need. Raising and increasing the fill rate there 11% year over year. We're in a great position this year to finish the year strong and start even stronger for next school year. So we've overcome some of those challenges. We're kind of in the post-COVID era when we had some effects from Ida also that affected. But we're excited about the progress that we have made, and we can see those projections going into the end of the school year and into next school year. So we put together some of the different incentives and retention that we do for our substitutes, so how we're able to retain our substitutes, and different unique things that ESS does to invest in our substitutes in a unique way. We do a lot of work to win incentives, so to get more people to show up every day, because as you know, substitutes only have to work when they want to work. So we try to incentivize to even just get what we tell them, if we can get you to work one more day a month than what you're currently working. And it's really worked this school year. We do corporate every month incentives. If they work 5 days, they're automatically enrolled. Lots of good incentives. We do gift cards and different things that we give away. But we also do a local-based incentive because those folks are competing against nationwide substitute pools for those corporate incentives. So we focus in, and that's one of the great things that Clarissa does here in Tangipahoa is she comes up with really unique incentives. We do like Thanksgiving, we gave away turkeys and hams. We do gift baskets, gift cards, all different things to incentivize them. We also do regional incentives, so outside of the national and the local. We did this year, November and December, where they had to work 15 days, and they had a $6,000 lottery that they could win, a $3,000 winner, $2,000 winner, and $1,000. And they were only competing against 3,000 subs or so within their region. And actually, Herman Leathers, that is a Tangipahoa ESS substitute, won the grand prize. He won $3,000. I know when Mike called him, he thought it was a prank. He thought it was a scam. He had to stop and say, are you serious? Is this real? You know, all of you show up every day to work, and, you know, I'm really appreciative. So that really helps. And what helped with that, too, it's a random winning, but because he won, our other substitutes are like, oh, this is real. Like, I can actually have a chance to win at these incentives. So that's increased our placements as well, because it really put kind of more realistic expectations behind it. We've also added in a Southside incentive this semester where it's a bonus program. So if they work in any of the Southside schools and they work a certain 15 days in the month, then they're entered into a $1,500 bonus. So we have at least four incentives that run every single month that they have an opportunity to win. We also have a referral program. The number one way that we get applicants is word of mouth. So nationwide, we have a $100 referral program, but we also more than doubled that to $250 just for this school district to help out with the need for substitutes. So we're excited. We push that out. Again, as I mentioned about the Southside bonus program for any of the Southside schools, we're getting a lot of good traction with that, and we just continuously share that, and it goes through the end of the school year. So another thing that we've been trying to do is pay for the background checks. So that is a hurdle a lot of the times, is the financial amount to pay the $50 for the background check up front. We have a Kickstart program that our company does since last year to help invest in the applicant's onboarding costs, where they are reimbursed after they work 25 days. But for those that Clarissa and Jaquetta talk to that just say up front, I just really don't have the funds, I'd love to get to work, we go ahead and pay for that. We get the money orders and pay for those. And that's helped increase our placements, specifically really in food service this year. We've been able to fully staff the food service substitutes for the first time with their vacancies. So that's really helped tremendously. Continued targeted recruitment, so they have some great upcoming recruiting. We've had past recruiting specific to the Southside area and across the district, but we focus on where our lowest or our highest need, lowest fill rate schools are, and we focus our recruiting around those. So we also do, everybody loves to hear that they're doing a great job. I think that's with anything. So we do an Employee of the Month recognition program. We have it corporate-wide, but again, they're competing against multiple substitutes across the country. So Clarissa and Jaquetta put in their own program where they recognize a food service substitute and a classroom substitute on a monthly basis. And it's not about the monetary value. They do get a gift from us, but it's coming to their school, recognizing them, and taking the time out to tell them they're doing a great job. So that's really that, and all of those things help lead to additional referrals and recruitment as well, because we try to provide this culture and this environment for them of showing appreciation on a regular basis that really contributes to our schools and to giving back to our schools. So these are just some of the onboarding updates. So we're receiving strong applicants in every month, every week. We have good, strong pipelines. We currently have 86 just that have just started an application or just submitted an application. and close to 200 of those in the pre-hire stage, which means they're just waiting on either a background check, orientation, or training, which we do hold weekly orientations to process our applicants a lot quicker and to get them through the process, like I said, a lot faster. So we have exceeded or met our hiring goals in this district each month. Clarissa and Jaquetta have done a great job. We do know that there is a big need, so we are continuing to push and raise those goals and seeing what we can do each month differently. We want to keep what's working, but we're constantly trying to see what we can do to get to that next level. And I really feel like they're on their path to do that. So one of the things that I talked to Mr. Vitter about as well is the district is possibly looking at a background check system, like to do in-house fingerprinting. Right now, with the way that it's set up through the Louisiana State Police, we can't be billed for the background checks because you have to have a money order. But if you have your own in-house system, then we can be billed, which that will allow us to pay for everybody's background check up front, which is going to expedite the hiring process. It's us investing in our substitutes, investing in the district. We've agreed to split that cost with the district with the background machine, in addition to being invoiced and paying for all of our ESS substitutes backgrounds moving forward. So as you can see here at the bottom, our new hires this year, this was just as of last week, was at 364 new hires compared to 210 the previous school year. So we're really, as I mentioned, we're really seeing that momentum. And with we continue to put all of these pieces together and work together again with the district to split the cost of the machine and go ahead and pay for all those up front, I see that being even more. You know, I'd love to see that doubled, or you know, up to 500, you know, or so that we could get. So that would really put us in a great place for summer. Summer is one of our heaviest recruiting, but we do recruit all throughout the school year, and we're consistently seeing those numbers. As you can see, it's about a 57% increase year over year. These are just some of the pictures of them doing the sub appreciation and different items, but I just, like I said, condensed it down to three slides for y'all since I knew you all had the presentation previously. We're definitely open to any questions or anything that you all have that we can help answer.
Mr. Duncan.
Question.
Yes.
So just remind me from, I guess, my benefit and the public's.
Sure.
You assist us with subs for teachers, food service, and then what other support services do you assist with?
Paraprofessionals and clerical.
Paras.
And custodial.
You do custodians as well?
Yes.
Okay. And then on the paras, so food service, paras, clerical, and custodians.
Right, yeah.
And so on the food service, I noticed that you have a 97% fill rate. You've been really successful in filling those positions.
This year was our best year for that, yes. I think
on teachers, we're still, though, at a roughly a 50% fill rate.
It was, I think, about 60%, yes.
Up to 60% now?
Mm-hmm. Okay. 11% lower last year, I believe.
What about paras? What's your fill rate on the paras?
Should be around. I can pull it and break it down for you by position type.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have that with me, but I can pull that out separately.
Do you think it's closer to the teacher rate or to the food service?
Closer to the teacher rate, yes.
All right. And then clerical, do you know that one offhand by chance?
They're usually only put in on an as-needed basis more so.
We don't have,
it would be a higher rate because not all clerical absences go in.
Yeah, we don't have very many of those. So.
Correct.
And then what about custodians?
Custodial vacancies are filled higher because, the pay rate is higher for the vacancies. And the so if it's an employee absence for custodial, it's probably a lower fill rate. I'd have to pull the exact.
And then I hope I'm not catching you off guard with this question, because we talked about this as an option with admin. So is there any interest from ESS in breaking this contract out to where we perhaps would not continue with the teachers' contracts, but maybe continue with support services, or are y'all not in a position to? Is it kind of an all or nothing type?
I mean, I think that we would be,
I think it's something that we would have to discuss. I mean, obviously the teachers are our primary source of, from a revenue perspective,
mm-hmm.
because they're, you know, from a volume perspective, the teachers are the largest
but that's not something you're really ready to.
We would have to sit down and talk through some numbers to see how that would how that would look.
Yeah. Okay. How quickly do you think y'all could get back to us on that if that was a direction we were more interested in looking at?
Probably by the end of the week.
Okay. All right, that was all my questions.
Any other questions?
Yeah, just, you know, there's a lot of moving parts to this, and we understand the how tricky it is to get subs and to keep subs occupied and to, you know, get it in our school system. We've had a lot of issues keeping the classrooms filled, and I guess the biggest question that I would have is tell us from a perspective, what is this costing us for the service? I know if we did it ourselves that we would have to increase the number of personnel that work for us on doing this, because we used to do it for ourselves, but on, from your standpoint, what is the selling point for us? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
What are we paying for the service? What are we paying for those hourly employees?
Yeah, so I'll take that. So essentially, we pay the substitutes what you dictate that we pay them, right? So whatever that pay rate is, that's what we pay that substitute, regardless of what position they're in. We then place a markup on that pay, which I believe is 2.6?
1.26.
That's what I was going to say.
Yeah, so it varies by position, but 1.26 is the
teacher's
pay.
Yeah.
So that the majority of them are coming in at 1.26. So that is all in.
So
cost.
A 25% or 26%.
26%
increase.
Increase, right. So within that, we take out all of the payroll taxes. So we have Social Security, we have state unemployment, federal unemployment on the employer side. We also have workman's comp. We have all of our insurances. So everything falls onto ESS from a responsibility perspective. So if there's any issues with the subs, you know, they get hurt, we go through the workman's comp, all goes through us. Also on top of that, obviously we have on-site staff. We have two individuals that work, you know, for Tangipahoa exclusively. So that's all kind of built into that rate. Any type of marketing, the $3,000 that we gave away, that you don't get charged back for that at all, right? So all of these incentives, a lot of these things that we do on the background checks, we don't charge back for. So a lot of these things, gift cards, the, you know, the different incentives, we don't charge you back for, because we're trying to incentivize those substitutes to get into the classrooms or into the facilities, whatever position they're in, because that helps you, it helps us.
Do any of your customers have like a sliding fee to where like you reach a threshold of 70% fill rate or 80% fill rate, that it goes to, you know, from 1.15, 1.26, 1.30, to where the more you fill, the better your percentage is, the more money you make. Does that make sense? Just like you're doing to the teachers, you're incentivizing them to participate. How would it be for us to have a system where you make more money the higher the fill rate is?
I'm not familiar. In my territory, I don't have any contracts like that, but I mean, that is something that we can entertain. I mean, we could look at that.
Yeah, and we only get paid if they're filled.
Yeah.
So like that's always, you know, we don't bill for any unfilled position. We're only billed for the filled position.
Yeah, we're very incentivized to get as many fills
right.
as possible.
Yeah, you make more money the more people you fill,
correct.
But there is no penalty for not filling a position. You know, you see what I mean? Mm-hmm. There's no, anyway.
Can I follow up on Tom's question? Mm-hmm. And this might not be a question for you guys, so if y'all will let me bring Mr. Dinko up to the microphone.
Yeah.
Because Mr. Toler had mentioned that if we didn't have this service provided to us, that we perhaps would have to hire employees. As I recall, when we entered into this agreement, we didn't eliminate any positions by bringing them in. The selling point, and I'm asking you to correct me if I'm wrong, the selling point for us was that this was going to help take some of the burden off of our APs and principals at the school level, that by having this in place, that it would kind of relieve them of the burden of having to find the people
to
fill these
positions.
To make the
6 o'clock call to find someone that canceled, exactly.
Right.
Yes, sir.
So we didn't eliminate any positions. It was to try to help alleviate that burden. Am I remembering this
correct.
Correctly?
And the one thing ESS does also is they pay for the frontline system. Mm-hmm. So that's, I think we used to pay 48 to 50,000 and they pay, I think, 30 to 35 because they get kind of a bonus. So that would be something else we would have to pick up also.
Okay. And look, I'm not, I understand that the what ESS has had to face when they came in to start doing this is not their fault, at least not entirely. I mean, they came in and did this right in the height of a pandemic and hiring shortages and all that. But what I will say is that what I have heard from our APs, at least the ones on the south end that I represent, is that they were not relieved of any burden when we went to this system, that it's actually become more complicated, again, not because of ESS necessarily, but because of what we've been faced with, that now instead of just having to get subs, they're having to help secure subs through ESS. Then when they don't have a sub, they're having to figure out which teachers are going to fill what classes, that this has been much more complicated and difficult of a time when it comes to teachers than ever before. Is that what you're hearing?
Yes, sir. When okay. we did the survey, and it was, we got the same exact responses that, you know, ESS was supposed to help with filling. I'm still having to call subs. And then we had some completely opposite that were extremely happy with the service that ESS gives them. So it was roughly 50-50. Exactly, I think it was 55 that was against ESS and 45% that was for ESS.
And then if we broke that out by types of positions, high satisfaction rate in our food service areas, high satisfaction with support staff, generally not so high when it came to teachers.
Correct.
Okay.
And teachers, as you mentioned, was the big one because if I'm out, then I've got to find someone to cover those X number of classes that I have.
And then last question, and you and I talked about this in a prior meeting, but can you talk about, particularly with teachers and the challenge in using ESS, and then I would like ESS to see if they have a response to this, but the issue that comes up with using ESS for teaching subs and the difficulty that creates in using retired teachers to fill those sub spots.
As we mentioned at the retreat, the retirement return to work laws is a hodgepodge of different avenues that you can go depending on when you retired. You have to sit out the year. The issue with ESS working with the retired teachers is it's considered a contract and it could impact their retirement. It honestly could stop their retirement if it was done incorrectly.
So there's a whole pool of people out there that are highly experienced teachers that would be willing to sub for us, but because we only offer that through possibly willing to sub for us, that they, because we only offer that through ESS, they're not willing to consider coming
and
in.
What we have done is we have, especially for our, let's say, maternity leaves and our extended, we are able to put them in and kind of a vacancy role or a limited role on what we call our green timesheets. So we'll be, I don't want to say we're able to skirt around the contract aspect, but we're kind of paying them through us, and it's a little different avenue than them going through a contracted service with ESS.
So we've come up with a workaround, but again, that makes this whole thing more complicated for our APs and principals.
Correct, yes, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, I'm done, thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
And did ESS, do y'all have a?
Well, no, I was just gonna say, it's like I said, I appreciate the time and just the trajectory that we're on. If we do get that opportunity, we'd love that opportunity to show them, to continue on that. And we do have like the 1 year renewal versus, you know, the three that we were currently in. So it give an opportunity for us to come back this time, you know, if we need to do each board meeting or through the, you know, twice a year to show where we are and where that progress is continuing to move upward.
Okay. Thank you.
Hello.
I'll make a motion.
Okay.
I have a motion.
So we have an option to have a 1 year contract versus a three.
Yeah, the renewal would just be for 1 year.
Okay. And we also have an option that maybe we can.
Yeah, I'm gonna make a motion.
Okay.
All right. Okay. When is the contract?
So our contract, does it end at the end of the school year or is it gonna end?
June 30th.
June 30th. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Okay. Item C, consider approval to renew the contract with the extended school services
for 2023 to 2024 school year.
All right. Madam President, I will move at this time to authorize the superintendent to enter into negotiations for a three-year contract with ESS for support workers only, but not to renew for teachers.
Okay. Do we get a second?
I'll second.
Okay. It's been motion and second. Any questions? Okay.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. Is our personnel department ready to handle filling all these vacant teacher positions, or?
What the personnel department will do is, if the board agrees to this, we will screen the applicants, do all the paperwork to put them into the system, do fingerprints, check fingerprints. When they go into the frontline system, if I'm a teacher at ABC High School, I'm going to be out tomorrow, I put my absence in, the system tries to fill the absence. If it doesn't, then it's left to someone up at the school to try to contact someone to fill my absence because it wasn't filled by the system.
Mr. Jenko, I kind of follow up to that. I remember when we did ASOP. I remember when we had that system in place, and it was a mess and a nightmare at some points, and it was good in other areas. I just want to make sure that if we decide we're not going to use ESS, that we've learned from some mistakes, maybe taken some things and upgraded it to where we're not going to have that issue on the front lines of filling these subs. Because, like you said, APs are struggling enough to deal with what we have now. I don't want to cancel something and then they have a bigger hornet's nest on their hands. So if we decide not to renew the ESS, I want to make sure that our personnel department is prepared and has a good system in place.
I just want to understand that when if we will do whatever we need to do, but the personnel department will not fill the subs. The personnel department will do the processing of the individuals that want to be subs. They go into the system, then the system will contact them to say, hey, there's a job at ABC High School, do you want it? If they accept it, then they go in for the sub. But if no one selects it, school personnel will make the call to fill that, okay. Not individuals in the personnel department.
Right. That's the only thing I just want to make sure, because I don't want
to
come
up with
that issue
again. I would
love to say
if personnel takes over, we're going to have 100% fill rate.
Yeah.
But, you know, now we, you know, we can bring someone on to be here at 6 o'clock in the morning and try to fill those, but our fill issues are on the south end.
Right.
You know, basically in the Taubman South is where the issues are.
Right. Because I remember many mornings that I had put in a request. I didn't have a sub in place. Like, nobody took the job, and that position went unfilled.
Yes, sir.
And I know we're still dealing with some issues like that. I just want to make sure we're prepared as an administration. If it is bringing on somebody on board, or if it's putting together a team, that's something we might need to know as a board and maybe act on it. So we can probably eliminate that issue.
Mr. Jenko, as I recall, at a personnel committee meeting earlier this evening, we actually approved a job description to fill a position that had been opened and unused for quite some time.
The human resources coordinator, correct.
Which part of their responsibility is for recruitment.
To modernize.
And modernize.
Yes, sir.
So.
And we have until June 30th to.
And that's the kicker. Yeah, you have until June. Mm-hmm. And then the thing is, as a coordinator, that's for recruitment. That's not really so much as for staff, like preparing that staffing for that day or trying to fill the position.
For that day has always been done at the school level. It's still going to be done at the school level.
You know, and I think the thing we would do as an administration is just explain the importance of making sure the system is working the way it needs to work, make sure our employees know that and our administrators know how they need to make sure it's set up.
Question. Okay, they just said that they may not be willing to do just that side of it.
Correct.
Break out the teachers.
Right.
So what's our situation if that happens?
Well, right now we're just authorizing the superintendent to enter those negotiations and see what they're willing to do, and hopefully sweetening it by a three-year contract instead of a one-year renewal will give them the sweetener they need to do it.
Can we get a deadline, seeing as we have until June? That way we can have some time to put something in place in case it doesn't fall through.
Next meeting.
Okay.
Yeah. We'll have a recommendation for the next meeting.
That's fine.
And how many employees do we have that are not date that are on our through ESS that are working almost full time
not those. As a sub, that they're almost full-time through ESS. How many employees do we have like that?
I don't know the number, but I know as when a vacancy occurs here as we move forward, we will be using an ESS employee to fill them, because if we hire someone March 1st, March 2nd, you're taking the X number of days they're going to work and divide that out over 5 months. And it's most individuals don't want to work for that full time. And they want a guarantee for the following year. And with our in certain individuals, we're not able to guarantee. So I would imagine it's a handful. I don't know the exact number of individuals that are with ESS, like Mr. Lathers. Mr. Lathers is one.
Right. Okay. Very good. So what we're saying now, we're going to consider the approval to renew the contract. I understand we're cutting out the teachers and support workers and saying support workers only, but item C says consider approval to renew the contract.
We're amending that.
We're amending. So we hadn't amended it.
Right. Well, no, there was no motion. That was just the agenda item to give the public notice of what we were talking about.
Okay.
So
okay.
In response to that agenda item, my motion is to authorize the superintendent to negotiate a 3-year contract with ESS for support employees only and not for teachers. And then I can amend that to say with the board to receive the results of that negotiation process at, for final consideration at our next school board meeting.
Okay.
If Ms. Dominguez will allow that.
Also, you got that, Ms. Cindy?
It also doesn't mean that we can't come back in another meeting or two
and do something totally
different. Different.
That's back up. That was my question.
Because this doesn't, end it. This just starts the negotiation process with her.
I'd like to call for a question on that.
Okay. Question?
Yes.
With the final amendment? Yeah.
Yes, please.
Motion to authorize the superintendent to negotiate the 3-year contract with ESS for support employees only and not for teachers, with the board to receive this for final consideration at the next board meeting.
Okay.
Is that
correct?
Yep.
Right. Yep. Okay. So before we vote on that, are we making this option non-negotiational? I mean,
We're authorizing negotiations.
Okay.
So we're asking her to get into that. We're giving her direction kind of on where we're leaning and asking her to have those conversations.
Can we take out the number 3 years in case she wants to do it for a 1 year?
We can say up to 3 years.
Or can we do just a contract with ESS?
One of our options a moment ago was just to renew
1 year.
1 year, yeah. Exactly as they are today. That we may find that might be the best deal going forward.
Right.
We can still do that.
Yeah, we could have that.
I'm saying instead of putting 3 years, put a contract. That way you don't have the word three, you don't have the number 3 there.
I'd like to leave it the way it is. We're authorizing her to enter negotiations.
There you go.
Yeah,
okay.
That's better.
It's a negotiation.
Motion to authorize.
No, I'd like it to read the way that I read it, you read it earlier. That's the motion I made. I mean, I could go with up to 3 years, but
up to three years.
For support employees.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then for the final all the other stuff you said about final consideration at the next. Yeah, I'm good with that.
Call to vote.
Oh, shoot. Did it lock me out?
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Consider committee reports. A, Finance and Audit Committee, February 7th, 2023. Can I get a motion?
Make a motion.
Motion by Robin.
Second.
Second by Brett.
Question.
Question.
Okay, one of our things we kind of moved forward for Mr. McNeely to do something about Punchdale High School's athletic park, bathroom stuff. Have we got anything to report on that before we vote on this? Because it kind of leaves us hanging. You're required to, if the board is interested in moving forward with the project, committee requested Mr. McNeely to consult Mr. Kudran, board attorney, on legalities of the facility. Do we have it? Do we know anything?
So I've talked to Mr. Kudran. He recommended, if you remember, that we not enter into an agreement where Ponchatoula would construct it. So Terry and his staff have been working on that particular project, along with some discussions about Kentwood and Independence also. So we're looking at potentially the same type facility and be able to come back to you with all of those. But right now, we're not at a position to say, here's the plan, here's the design.
Okay, but we're working on
what
we requested. Okay, yes. I just want to make sure, because I mean, you know the timeline they had, so I just want to keep with the timeline, too.
Okay, we're good? Call to vote, Ms. Sidney.
Voting is open. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Okay. Item B, Finance and Audit Committee.
Motion to table to next meeting.
I'm sorry.
All three of them?
All three of them? Or?
No.
No, just
the tonight, February 28th.
You want to table the audit request and the banking request as well?
We can pass one, or we can vote on one and two and table three.
You do that. Well, still want to get back into the habit, like our policy calls for, is sending the committee reports to the meeting 2 weeks after that.
We got time.
That's the intent.
Yeah. He's made a motion to table. I'll second it, and that's a non-debatable motion.
Okay. All right, so that one's
until tabled. The next board meeting, Mr. Toler.
Okay. Item C.
Wait.
Hold on, we got to
vote on?
Yep.
Okay.
Vote to table.
To table it.
To the next board meeting. It's got to be specific.
Okay.
To the next. It's already been motion and second.
Voting is open.
Okay.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Okay. Okay. Item C, Personnel Committee, February 28th. Are we going to do
table?
Table.
Second.
Motion. Second to table.
To the next board.
To the next board meeting.
Who made the second?
Brett.
No, Mr. Piazza.
Okay. No.
Piazza.
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 Little Joey.
Voting is open.
Every day.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Okay. At this time.
I admit that would all do honor and respect, Joey.
No, yeah, I mean, it's okay. I got you.
Okay. At this time, we're going to move item 6B, consider approval to the resolution to ratify and confirm an agreement with the town of Kentwood for the use of the baseball field for the Kentwood High Magnet School baseball team. And we are honored to have with us this afternoon Mayor Irma Garten, and who is also a retired Tangipahoa Parish school teacher. Mm-hmm. So, and from being in that area, we know how she is and how she has the heart of our children in that area. And so we're more than happy to reach this agreement and to come in for our children. Any questions? Oh, yeah, no. I need a motion.
Motion and a second.
Thank you.
Move to adopt the recommendations of the administration.
Okay. Tom and Mr. Westmoreland. Okay. Any questions?
Is this the same exact wording that we received last week?
No. No, there were some changes.
Okay, yeah. Well, what was the changes?
One of the big changes was that the first change was the city was wanting the gate money, and the school needed the gate money to pay for the referees and the umpires or whatever. So that, I believe that, Ms. Irma, if that's correct, that was one change. But everything else, as far as the verbatim of field maintenance and things like that, is all the same.
Okay. Any other questions? Call vote.
Voting is open.
Cost is minimal, and that's a good deal for the school system.
Yeah. Thank you, Ms. Gordon.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Play ball.
Okay. At this time, we will hear from our superintendent reports and recommendations.
Thank you, Ms.
Earl. Yes, thank you, Ms. Mayor Garden. Thanks for being here. We appreciate you. At this time, we have next on the agenda to consider approval of the 2023-24 school calendar. I shared the calendar with you. I think it was option two. Dr. Purcell had the most support from both families and employees. We asked for input and feedback from our families, and some of the feedback that we received, the trend was to have the week of Mardi Gras off. So this option 1A is that change. It's basically the most popular calendar with the feedback of Mardi Gras week off, and there's four emergency days built into the calendar. We even specify that if those days aren't used, 2 days would be used for first semester. It tells you at the bottom of the calendar which days would be given back to the schools or to the teachers and all as days off. And then the second semester, it also says which days would be taken off at the end of the year. There's also an additional paid holiday for school staff to complete their safe school videos. They can do those anytime during the year that they want to do. They can actually start on them in the summer. But, instead of the compensation of paying them so much stipend to do it, the paid holiday is the compensation for, because those videos it's like a full day when you sit there and do it, if you do it at one time. So we felt like that was something that we wanted to do for our employees, was to add that into the calendar as well.
I make a motion to accept the recommended calendar.
Second.
And thank you for taking the feedback and from the parents as well. I know that was a new thing for us this year, and from us as well. We appreciate you.
Question.
So what happens if we give these days and then after that first semester we have something happen, because you know how it happens for us, seems like every year. So where do we build in that time that we gave them the days back? Do you mean like if we say something would happen second semester? Yes. And we already gave them. Given those 2 days. So we would use the 2 days. So we have 2 days for the second semester. This bank, in the calendar. So we would use those 2 days. And if it was in excess of those 2 days, we would either add something at the end of the year or add time to the day. Okay. That's usually the options we have. Most prefer time added to the day over adding a day.
Call for a vote.
Voting is open.
Make sure she
Okay, y'all do that next.
The one we added to.
Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you. At this time, we would like to do the agenda item that was added at the beginning of the meeting unanimously by our board, which is an update from Mr. Terry Vallaruta on the drainage issue at Kentwood High School and also for Sumner High School particularly, an update on what's been done to address the water in those two facilities. And I think there's a couple more school campuses that you've looked at as well.
Yes, ma'am.
Classrooms. Go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, I've been to Kentwood, Laranger, Sumner, and I'm going to put Perrin on the list too, but I haven't had a chance to visit Perrin yet. The flooding at Kentwood, the water's going into the original building, into the basement, and it's been so many times that there's mud forming on the floor.
Yeah.
And so I was taken back by having to walk through the red mud in the bottom of the floor. And then, so I talked to engineers at GoTech, and they have a proposal. Kentwood has so many different elevations, and it's a very complicated site with the buildings being dropped where they were, and the way the water's shedding off the football field, the gym, and across the street from the other side of that campus, shedding onto that road, and it's basically a river running down that road and then turning, and the main building acts as a dam. And so with that, GoTech has proposed to do some site analysis, a site survey. They want to analyze the stormwater management and flooding issues. They want to analyze the stormwater management to improvement alternatives to offer the suggestions on how to improve it, and then design the stormwater management improvements. So once, right before we get into that design mechanism, we'll have some cost of what this construction is going to cost. And it'll probably be a couple $100,000 to mitigate the money now. The good thing about this is it appears to meet the requirements for hazard mitigation money for the study and for the work to take place. So that's the angle that I'm going to pursue hazard mitigation money. And the total cost for just Kentwood is roughly $89,000. And that includes topographic survey, the stormwater management analysis, the analysis of the improvements, design, and then bidding assistance and construction administration. So it's a whole thing.
Question on it. And that, Terry, that's just on the drainage issue, right?
The stormwater drainage issues. It covers the entire block.
So while we're still on Kentwood, can we go ahead and talk also about the lab, the science lab? Do you have anything
yes,
that you're
sir.
Working on for that?
Looked at the science lab, and at the end of this week, our small projects RFQ for architects is going to be available, and we'll let y'all review that. Mm-hmm. And then when that comes back, that's going to be one of the first projects that we pass off to the small projects. But that definitely needs to take place. I worked in New Orleans on these projects, remodeled a similar lab with a similar setup.
And will that include addressing the flooring in that lab and the
that whole room mm-hmm. for where that science lab is? It'll address everything in that room that needs to take place.
Mr. Jerry, it was also the hallway too that was the flooring.
And then we talked about that. For me, I imagine that the unevenness of the flooring in the hallway has resulted from, you know, the continuous moisture that's been in that basement for over a period of time. I don't know if that's permanent deformation. If it could be
right. There's also another number of items that need to be addressed and looked at in those buildings, and we are prepared to do that as well.
Thank you, Mr.
There is an issue with the junior high school science lab.
Okay.
I just want to make sure that gets included in the assessment for
yes, sir. To be done. Moving forward, there's a lot of our buildings that have a lot of issues that need to be addressed, mm-hmm. and we need to do an assessment, a proper assessment of all of our buildings that we're working on, and I'm gathering the initial information in order to get the assessment number that we need, because there's from the past assessment that was done 6 years ago, because of the storm, there's initial issues that have been compounded because of the storm and because of the age of our buildings. And the age of our buildings is really needs to be addressed. And, okay. and we'll have to look at the assessment, bring it to the board, develop priorities from the board's perspective, and then we can implement a plan based off of what all the total assessments need across the board for all of our schools and support buildings.
And that's the
global idea.
We definitely appreciate all that you're doing. We really do. And being hands-on. As you're saying, we're talking about the Kentwood area. Can you also, and because I'd be remiss if I didn't say it, and she's sitting in the audience, and I get these calls. But I was out there the other day at O.W. Dillon. I'm still confused as to why we don't have that ornament, because when we were out there and trying to get those children and it was raining, I mean, we were soaked. I even videoed it because we were soaked out there.
Yes, ma'am.
When they threw the carpool line, there's nothing. And I was told that it was supposed to be in the contract to have it done. And it just never had been finished or completed. So please add that one on
yes,
there
ma'am.
With it. Thank you.
Yeah, just one quick thing. You know, Kentwood, the city block that Kentwood High School sits on is probably close to the highest elevation in Kentwood that there is. That's why the water tower is right by the football tank, or football field. But it's as we have added buildings over the years, we haven't, you know, completely done the best job of making sure that the drainage. So the football field's higher than the school, and the junior high was added, then concrete. And I say all that to say, even though we're on the top of the hill as opposed to Ponchatoula, water's still an issue, and getting water to leave away from buildings should be part of our plan moving forward in all these construction projects, and especially on the south end. We don't want to create new problems when we add these new buildings in by not looking at just the hydraulics of it and how do we get water to leave an area. But anyway. I know we're on the right track.
And so, Mr. Terry, you had said that you were looking at using GoTech to do a similar analysis at some other campuses?
Right, at LaRonja, Sumner, and Perrin. Okay. And those costs will come in this week.
One last thing. Do we have anybody else, you know, Mr. Terry, that we could get comparable bids from or
yes,
similar services?
As we move, I wanted them, because our children's feet are getting wet, I consider this an emergency, and so I called on GoTech because I'm familiar with their work and I know how diligent they are, that this needs to be corrected as soon as possible. So that's why I moved with this company, and moving forward we'll look at additional companies and to spread the this type of work out, because it needs to be done, you know, and then but there is a plan to be competitive and to share the design responsibilities for all the hydrology studies that need to do at just about all of our schools.
Yeah, especially at LaRonja. That's what I was going to say. Make yeah. sure that
LaRonja's on the list. There's, you know, it's subsurface drainage. We're already starting to clean the subsurface drainage at these specific three schools, at Kentwood, LaRonja, and a little bit at Sumner, just to help with the mitigation, because that's been that's an initial cause. But the overarching cause is just the amount of buildings that's been placed without implementing the civil plans that were drawn up at the time, and it's overtime and neglect.
And so the administration's recommendation is to go forward with these hydrology studies at these four schools using GoTech, and then y'all will come back to us with the plans that they design. Is that?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Once we get those good hard numbers, and we'll present
and
them.
And then
back
you're also working on that assessment for these other things that we.
Yes, sir. It's a separate. Yes, sir.
So I'll, unless Mr. Tom wants to make the motion, I'll make the motion to adopt the administration's recommendation.
I'll second.
Any other questions?
Just a while ago, you said something about the amount of money that it was going to be at Kentwood, but this is money you're trying to get back through hazard mitigation?
Yes, ma'am.
From the government, right?
Yes, ma'am. Free
but
money.
But we have to pay for it first?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
In this situation.
And yes, we hope to get it back, or we think we will get it back?
It meets the qualifications.
Okay.
It's a fancy way of saying it.
Yeah. Like that,
very,
huh?
Very good.
Well, we hope
that
to get
smooth.
It back.
That was smooth.
Yeah, I like how you worded that.
That's a Jeff McNeely word.
That's what I was about to say.
I've been hanging out with my brother.
They've been hanging out a lot, I could tell.
Oh, question.
Voting is open. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Jinx us, but we have agreed on a lot of stuff lately.
Why did you even open your mouth?
Thank you, Mr. Terry. We appreciate the update and your quick attention to those issues. I don't know. I'll mess up on this agenda. I think it's 5B. Am I right?
Right.
5B. Is to consider approval to authorize the superintendent to negotiate a purchase price to not to exceed the appraised value of the property for the Yoakum Road Sanctuary property. This is we need to make a motion.
So move.
Okay.
I'll second. Discussion. Go ahead.
Move forward. I didn't hear what the motion was.
I think the motion, I'm asking, consider approval to authorize the superintendent to negotiate a purchase price not to exceed the appraised value of the property for the Yoakum Road Sanctuary property. And I think Tom first.
Yeah, that was the question. What was his motion?
And so you're not, just so I'm clear, this is not authorizing to enter into a purchase agreement. This is authorizing to begin the negotiation process, and you would come back to us with the results of that negotiation for us to make a final decision on actually entering into a purchase agreement or not. Is that?
That is correct.
Okay.
So this would not authorize me to, or the administration to do any purchase. It's just to try to get to a, negotiate a price that we feel like the board would be comfortable with, and also the seller. And then come back to you guys for approval for the actual, if that's something that works out.
Tom?
The reason I made the motion quick is because, you know, I was, in all honesty, I was a little concerned when we bought Yoakum School. I was not sold on the idea because I typically lean toward new construction and buying. But when it was all said and done, the price per square foot for construction easily sold me on the idea that we made the right call at Yoakum with the square footage that we bought for that price. And I'm hoping that this is another example of buying something at a good price and putting it to good use. So that's why I'm supporting it.
Okay, I mean, initially, you know, my objection for the Yoakum Road property was because of my own personal issues about Yoakum Road.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I still have those. Okay. My feelings toward this now is, you know, for what purpose, right? Because I'm not clear.
Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Moore, the purpose, if the stars and the moon align and, you know, we're able to negotiate something that we're comfortable with and the board approves it, the vision for this would be to expand pre-K seats for our four-year-olds across the parish. So I think the estimate is maybe up to 200 more pre-K slots for students. And it would be open to any students in the parish, not to a particular area. So the challenge that we have right now is that, you know, pre-K is grant funded. So every year we apply, Ms. Corman Brabham is the coordinator. We apply for the funds to pay for the teacher and the para that works with our pre-K students, okay? And there's very strict guidelines for that. The challenge is the facilities, the classrooms, to have more pre-K. So we could ask for more grant funding to have more pre-K, but the challenge is the classrooms for pre-K, right? And the grant can't pay for that, for the classroom part. So this is an opportunity that we can use ESSER dollars, which is the federal dollars, and I asked Ms. Cece for the, Ms. Lanier, who heads up our federal programs, and you know, she explained to me that the federal dollars can be used for this. There, that the LDOE has priorities that they identify. Okay, so if a project like and pre-K is a priority, right? Because we know longitudinal data tells us that students who attend pre-K programs, quality pre-K programs, do better in school, and they have a higher chance of reading on level by third grade, on, you know, proficient, and they're set up for success. So this is a priority under ESSER funds through LDOE, and ESSER funds have to prepare, respond, prevent the transmission of COVID. There are three different legislative acts. She's explaining all this to me. And this facility would fit in with the priority, and it also provides more space for classrooms for students. So it meets the criteria. She's already has the first hurdle, which is approval through LDOE to use the funds to purchase the building. And so we know that we can use ESSER for it, but now we're at the point where we have to negotiate a price that we're comfortable with, and you know, that the board would want to do and move forward with that.
Okay. And Ms. Steele, these pre-K classes will be open to all of our children in Tangipahoa Parish, right?
Yes.
They didn't have to live in
right. Okay. And it would not take away classes from schools. So, you know, if Spring Creek has, you know, four pre-K classes, like, we're not moving them to Yoakum Road, right? They would still continue to have their classes, but if they don't have the room at the school, then we could accept students from Spring Creek at the Yoakum Road Pre-K Center.
The idea is to have more spots.
More spots, not takeaway spots, or move spots.
And Ms. Steele, could that also be used as an incentive to maybe attract more teachers? If the teachers would have the benefit of having their children in a pre-K program mm-hmm. that's paid for. Because I know as a parent, right, it's better than daycare. Because as a parent that has two little ones, that's a major impact for me. That's an incentive if I was working for Tangipahoa that I had free childcare.
Yeah, I think it's a great recruitment tool.
Right.
It's like, Mr. Jerry, Independence Elementary right now, I think we have two pre-K classes at Independence Elementary. The rest of our pre-Kers are at the Head Start program because we have no room for them.
No classrooms
for them.
Right.
So this would be an opportunity for people that live, say for instance, in Independence, that their child didn't get into pre-K, but they work in Hammond. I'm just going to go drop my kid off at Yoakum Road for pre-K because I got in that program, and we're keeping our kids in our pre-K programs. Whereas right now, we have no room to put any of them.
Ms. Steele, have we considered any other facility? I mean, I'm a number one component for pre-K.
Mm-hmm.
I know about the insufficient number of classrooms that we have and how many kids. I've heard from parents, you know, who are trying to get their kids into this pre-K. But are we considering any other facility for this particular?
I mean, I'm not aware of another facility that could create that many slots for pre-K. If you are, I mean, we'd like to look at it. No, but at this time, this is the one that we're aware of that we could easily turn into that many slots quickly by August.
And part of the attraction also, right, is that the central locality of this particular property and the room to expand it for other uses. I mean, there's cleared land there. It's centrally located where all of the population growth is. that there's not a whole lot of property out there that meets all of those criteria.
Hasn't been talked about too that we could possibly talk with parish government about making a straightaway through to Airport Road where they wouldn't even have to get off the interstate. Couldn't that road go all the way through to Airport Road?
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, one of the advantages of this particular site, Mr. Moore, besides pre-K, which is our number one priority to expand seats, is that the main sanctuary can hold about 3,400, 3,500 people, has a stage and all that. So it could be used for graduations. It could be used for, you know, if we had an employee rally for back to school, we could have our own there. We could also, plays or theater productions can be done there, where some of our schools now rent the Columbia. They could use that facility. So there's lots of opportunities at night and on weekends for it to be used in a lot of other ways.
I see a lot of opportunity as far as working with tourism and stuff as well. We have nothing in Tangipahoa Parish that we can house conferences. Like we're all, you know, we go to our conferences for Tangipahoa Parish school system goes to state conference. There's opportunities that we would be able to host this maybe. There's opportunities for us to be able to host different organizations as far as having where they didn't build a convention center. This can actually act as a convention center for out-of-state people to come to, and we can actually utilize that and rent it out. So, I mean, there's so many opportunities that we can use with 3,500 seats in one spot that, besides being great for us for pre-K.
Madam President, I commend the administration for the vision. I'm on board with it. I think we need more pre-K. The things that I see positive about is it's going to give us more room for pre-K. It's going to give us a little bit more room if we need to expand with Yoakum for the new, for the school there as well. It's a great commercial property right by the interstate, so if we ever wanted to add billboards or anything promoting the Tangipahoa Parish school system or a basketball game, or I think it's a wonderful thing. The only thing that I wanted to kind of bring to administration's caution is in those negotiations, understand we will have to do renovations for this project. These buildings are not made and equipped for what we're asking them to do currently at the moment. Not saying they can't. So when we go into the negotiations, like I said, just please be aware that you are going to have to bill also for renovations on top of whatever price y'all agree upon in a meeting. So I hope the buyer's aware of that. I mean, the seller that's aware of that, and we are aware of that.
I'd like to add to that, too. An inspection has not taken place. Is that correct? A physical inspection has not.
Well, just the appraiser. Well, okay. Mr. Terry, I think it was more of an appraisal that was done. Physical inspection is Mr. Anthony's asking about a physical inspection.
I'm just asking, has one taken place yet at Yoakum campus?
I've had an appraiser, outside appraiser.
Gotcha.
We had an outside appraiser come that looked and gave a full appraisal.
Yes, seen that.
Compared on other buildings of that of that type in the area and in Baton Rouge.
I've seen that. But we haven't had a physical inspection to check roof, HVAC, plumbing. You know,
not that yet.
We'll do that in the negotiation process, I assume, if we come to maybe terms. I did want to point out, I will echo that, you know, it may require renovations. I'm going to probably go over my boundaries here. I kind of wholeheartedly disagree with the appraisal. And I want to point that out now. That may help you during negotiations because there's no demand for this building. And that's the biggest component of an appraisal is demand and utility. There's probably only two or three entities in the area that can use a building like that, and probably only one or two that have the chops to finance it. And we're one of those two. So anyway, just take that into consideration when kind of negotiating the price point.
And not to mention, we did fall short the last time that we purchased a Yoakum Road property. There were a lot of things that were not discovered during the assessment that came back to haunt us.
Yes, sir.
I mean, things that were obvious, like the water, the sewer treatment system.
Yes, sir.
You know, that for me that was major. The other electrical problems that should have been discovered, you know, just
yes, sir.
And so, in the assessment. Those things most certainly, and I agree.
We can have those evaluated.
I agree with the But the other opinions that
we can have those evaluated for a cost.
Yes,
I would like, if the board, you know, authorizes us to negotiate, I would like to, for Mr. Anthony, since he is a realtor, to work with Mr. McNeely and I on negotiating with the owner, if you wouldn't mind helping us with that expertise.
Ms. Rose?
Yeah, I just, there's just several questions. I think it's great pre-K, although the grants that we get only cover for our employees, and it's not going to cover for running of the school and the cafeteria and the feeding. I mean, all of that's got to come out of something. So we have to think about that. It's not just like we're just buying the building with ESSER money, because we have to maintain it futurely. So that's a big concern for me. And also, we have so many, as you just stated a minute ago, how much we have to do on all our campuses. I just think this is a great thing, but it's a won't, not necessarily a must. And in the budget for the ESSER money that we've gotten, I would like to see that. What money do we have? How much are we getting? What are we using it for? And where does it fit in with all the needs that we really have to have? Like, because we do need cafeterias, auditoriums, things we've been wanting in all our campuses for years that we've never had the money to do. So I'm just saying, can we buy this building with ESSER money and also do the other things? But so we've never got any documentation on any of the money other than the first ESSER phase money we got, you know. But lately we hadn't got anything. So, I mean, I'm just about what we need, not so much that we really want this building. And I did know that before we had said it was a certain amount of money, and then when y'all talked to us a few months back, you said it was a lot of money, but it was all the property. So is this a change now that we don't have to buy all that surrounding property? We can just buy the three buildings and the parking lot? I mean, those are things that I like to know before I make a final decision. And of course, pre-K, are we gonna provide buses to bring the children, or is that gonna be something, all that's gotta be worked out and things like that before we can actually vote, I feel. Because, I mean, we don't have enough buses to transport the children we have now, much less transport kids from Spring Creek to Ponchatoula or to Yoakum. I mean, it's a lot to know and decide before we vote. So I understand this is just a negotiating process, and it would be great for us to get this, especially you say pennies on the dollar that we got before. Hopefully. But it's just a lot of unanswered questions right now that I'm hoping we can have a talk about.
Before we can ask any of those, we have to negotiate.
Yeah, the price. We have to, and the inspection for sure, because that was the first thing we told you last time. We really wanted the inspection of, and I know they changed all the roofs after Ida. And I think they've done some other work, but we don't know what that other work is. So, yeah, whatever work they've done on it to repair since we toured it, and then how much more money is it going to cost us to fix it? I mean, it's just a lot that I'd like for us to have some conversations about, you know, so we'll know to make a good vote or not, you know.
The building that we're talking about, what was it used for before?
It's three buildings.
It's three buildings.
Three buildings. And they were used for what?
It was
Harvest.
Church.
Two churches.
All three churches.
Which would be a different.
I think they had schools.
Yeah, they had Sunday school classes in there.
A bunch of classes.
It actually, when we looked at it, from my looking at it, there were preschool classes in there because they were constructed under the.
Especially in that second building.
No.
What we're calling the second building, which is what would be.
Church regulated.
Yeah.
No, they were regulated for child care.
Yeah, they even had bathrooms in each classroom that had the small toilets.
In the main sanctuary building?
Yeah.
Right. Those have attached child care bathrooms already built in and
right.
All that.
But back to the, if I could just say one more thing, Ms. President. So I know you got the appraisal, but like the appraisal come out of maintenance money? Or because we didn't know anything about the appraisal until we got it in an email. Like, how was that paid? And then if we get an inspection, that comes out of maintenance money?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
And where was the appraisal paid for out of?
Maintenance money?
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Other question?
Call question.
Yeah, just one more thing before we go. Okay. So the transformation, right?
Yes, sir.
From church to school. If we look at what it's going to cost to transform, I'd like to see those numbers.
Yes, sir.
And I would really like to see those numbers.
We're not changing the church building. We're converting the other building.
You're converting the other buildings, but we're purchasing the church. We're purchasing the church. You use it as an auditorium.
Yes, sir.
I see.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Jerry, I can clear. I've actually been in the building a couple times. So the big white building was a sanctuary. Like Melissa said, 3,000 seats or whatever. The smaller building at one time was all smaller rooms, and I think once they started to have trouble filling that big building, they kind of went down into the smaller building, which is now a sanctuary surrounded by classrooms. So to build it out to make it, I guess part of that could be cafeteria space or whatever, but just to clarify, but they do have, I believe, also classrooms inside the big sanctuary.
Yeah, I just toured it just two months ago. The whole bottom part, all the way around, is classrooms. Mm-hmm. It was Sunday school classrooms, but they were large classrooms with, like I said, small toilets and sinks for pre-Kers to be able to reach. But they had at least 12 classrooms that went around that sanctuary. And then the center of it is the sanctuary with the stage. And then there's a whole upstairs part too that has classrooms.
And then there's a third building that could also be converted for use.
Right.
For some
correct.
Sort
of. Mm-hmm.
So I think one thing we'll do is arrange a date that, you know, invite all the board members to come and visit the, you know, the, because I thought that I think that's probably needed. Is to actually go and look at it yourselves.
Yep. Anybody's watching this and selling it, we don't want it.
Yeah.
But at this time, we just want to give you the authority to negotiate.
I'll offer the question.
Okay.
Voting is open. Voting is closed. We have 8 yays and Mr. Moore abstained.
Thank you. Item 5C, we have to consider approval to refer a policy, EFAB, which is employee use of social media and electronic communication tools, to the policy committee. This is a policy that Ms. Dina Spears is at in technology. She's the assistant director. She's asking us to consider sending it for our revisions, and that the changes has to do with our switch from OnCourse to J Campus, and the words that are used in our current policy is more OnCourse rather than J Campus, and we just need to update those.
I'll make a motion. Approve it, or second, whichever.
Motion second by Ms. Abrams.
Okay. Question? Call the vote.
Voting is open. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Item 5D is our last item under the superintendent's report, and we have to consider approval of the substantial completion certificate for Natal Benny Middle School's re-roof project from Hurricane Ida.
Move to adopt administration's recommendation.
Second. Motion by Mr. Brent.
Okay. Anything?
Voting is open. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you.
All right, we waited through all of that.
Personal privilege, I guess.
That was all, guys.
No.
Okay, now we are at personal privileges. Mr. Joy, we'll start on your end.
Okay, all right. First things first, I'm just happy this calendar thing's over with. My wife has been aggravating me for months now about which calendar option and where we're leaning, and I'm glad that's over with. I think we came up with a pretty solid option that kind of put a lot of input in. So I want to thank the administration for taking the time to listen to their faculty and the board members and their, you know, opinions on that. But I would like at this time to kind of echo what Ms. Rose said earlier about we as a board. You know, I had the privilege today to get to go to Natal Benny Middle School to play a volleyball game for their PBIS event. And it's apparently clear when you walk on the certain campuses, the differences that you find among other campuses. So if I go to like Punchtula Junior High, for example, the facilities are a little bit better than if I walked into Natal Benny. I just want us as a board to kind of keep that in mind, guys. And I know that's in y'all's hearts and minds. We talk about it every board meeting. I just want to make sure that, you know, the right people are in place, and I think we have them, to address those issues. Because, like I said, I was in there today, and you literally sweat it so bad in the gym because they have no fans. They don't have any intercom systems. Those are immediate needs that you have to have to function as a school. And we get comfortable because, you know, we represent certain districts and certain boundaries. But I do highly recommend, if you haven't walked some of these campuses that you've never been to, I highly suggest doing that, because it's a very big eye-opener to what you can see across our parish. And, it, you know, we're only as good as our weakest school. If our weakest school is an F, we're an F. And that's just how I look at it, guys. And sustaining the growth, like I think the vision that we're going with for these new schools, for pre-K and stuff, is great. But I want to echo what Ms. Rose said. We do have a lot of things that we have to address here at home before we start getting the things we want. We need to address a lot of the needs. And that's some things that we've just neglected over the years. And it's nothing with anybody on this board or any previous boards. They did what they felt they had to do in that moment. But we're a board now that we have to start looking at things that are going to affect the board 20 years from now, not just tomorrow. Because we get in a bad habit here in Tanshboho. We try to put out the fire for tomorrow, and we end up starting a whole new one for 20 years down the line. That's the kind of things that I want to make sure our legacy as a board kind of maintains, is when we got here, we had a mess, and we cleared it up for the next guy. That's how I look at it. So I want to thank the new guys we have on board. I think they're doing a fine job doing that. Everything I've seen in y'all's reports and stuff like that have shown that. Continue the good work, guys, and if you could ever need anything from me, please contact me.
I'm glad we had a good meeting. I'm glad we all agreed on things. I don't have too much to say. Do want to invite everybody to the Sicilian Festival next weekend. Come get you some spaghetti and artichokes and Italian sausage and whatever else Italian you would like to try. Need any information, go to IndySicilianFest.com.
I'll be kind of quick too. I want to congratulate a lot of our basketball teams. We got the A-Meet girls are in the playoffs tomorrow night. I will be there to watch that. And also Punchtula girls are 8:00 on Thursday night. Looking forward to that as well. Want to congratulate Dustin Easley from LaRonger High School. That's another good hire. He hosted a home playoff game, and it's the first ever home playoff game that LaRonger High School has won. So congratulations to them. He's a friend of mine, and I was happy to see that. Again, I talk about this stuff I've mentioned it a few times. Teachers are so tremendously important. You make one right move, and it changes the culture of a school. So I'm just thankful for all the guys we have here, and looking forward to the conference coming up in a couple weeks. So.
You know what? You know what? We forgot about basketball. You know, the tall person thought about that.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Boys basketball for Punchtula is tonight, which we had to miss. So I hope that's good luck to them. But LaRonger, I actually was at that game. That was a nail biter, by the way. They came from behind. They were down the first half. Them boys kicked it in gear and pulled out a win. So congratulations to the LaRonger. I'm glad you reminded me, man. I had it on my notebook and I forgot it. So thank you.
Yeah, just want to thank Odobe Dillon for coming tonight. Just Peyton. Mm. Also, with the festival coming and promoting that, I actually had a question from a viewer that was asking, why are we promoting? You know, anytime that we can promote our local fairs and festivals, that's part of education. From the north end to the south end of this parish. So as people will watch, we'll have other fairs and festivals come and participate.
Well, I can answer that really well. When you bring people into Tanshboho Parish, that come for our fairs and festivals. They spend money in our parish, which helps us as a school system with our tax dollars.
Absolutely.
So if the more we promote our towns and our cities in Tangipahoa Parish, the more money we make.
Absolutely. And then just to follow up with one of the things that Rose said, our wants and our needs, and you know, I'd be remiss if I didn't say she's absolutely correct. And as we move forward with these construction, with different phases and all the different projects throughout the parish, I think one of the things that I've learned in the last couple of weeks is we as a board really want to see us more involved in the planning of these projects so that we get some input back from the architects, because they work for us, and the architects present us with the drawings and the renderings so that we all know what we're getting before ground is broken, so that we do balance our wants and our needs, so that we put money where we need to, because we need facilities in this parish to put children in seats to teach them. And that should be our focus, as well as making sure that we manage all the different areas that Terry's talking about with hydraulics and stuff to make sure that we're moving forward correctly. So I look forward to us making a few changes in that moving forward. Thank you.
Okay. Ms. Rose?
Well, congratulations to basketball, of course. Repeat that. I would like to say, too, that Panchula Football Boosters is having a big gumbo cook-off Saturday, and that's to raise money for the injured football players' reserve fund. And, of course, there's antique trade days, and there's all kind of stuff in Panchula this weekend. So hopefully people will come out and support. And thank you all for everything. Appreciate you. Again, I'll say it again. Appreciate the opportunity to weigh in on that calendar, because that is a big thing to our constituents and our families, that they have an opinion, and we appreciate that they were able to get that. And like I said, we have a lot of needs that need to be addressed, and just wanting to see us continue to move forward, because that's what we've been doing. That's our goal, and I think we've been doing a good job at that. So thank you for our administration and all our new people and people for working hard to do that. Ms. Wesson?
I'm good.
You good? Okay.
Thank you.
It's Jerry?
Okay, and I know you guys are going to get tired of hearing me say this, but I will remind you as many times as I have the opportunity that the reason that we're here, and this goes for, you know, for my fellow board members, for our teachers, our principals, for everyone in the parish, that the reason that we're all here are the children. They created the need for each one of us to be here looking after what happens with the funds that the board receives and the school system receives to educate our children. I think that those needs would also, should also, and hopefully inspire and our teachers, our principals to, you know, give some extended thoughts to how we handle our children as far as the discipline, because every time a child receives discipline, it that child will bear that scar forever. That's something that they will never forget. And so we should apply the one thing that I believe that is going to be the resolution for our problems, and that is the gift of love. You know, and if it's, and I will say this and say this again, love is unconditional, or you need to use a different word. And so we cannot look at the act alone. We need to find out why, you know, and we have to invest. We have to invest in the well-being and the mental status of our children to improve that, so that they can improve their performance, and then we look better when our GPA goes up, and it is the unit of measurements for how successful the school is, the system is. It is how well our children do.
Okay. Brett, you good? Still.
Yeah, I just want to say, in addition to the ball games that we have this week, we have pre-K registration. Our sign-up starts tomorrow, March 1st. And parents can call 748-2454 to talk to a real person and sign, get them signed up for pre-K. And I hope and pray that we can offer every child that signs up a spot and a place in a pre-K classroom this year. Secondly, we have our first district-wide magnet showcase Thursday night. at 5:30 at the arena here in a meet. We'll have all of our magnet school programs there, the administrators, maybe some teachers with tables, so that to really give parents and students an opportunity to get a taste and answer, ask questions and get questions answered about all of the different magnet programs that we have, which are free to our parents. So we'll be doing that on Thursday. And then also in the month of March, parents will have an opportunity to visit magnet schools as a follow-up. Gives them like the whole month of March to kind of learn about all the programs. And then April 1st, we'll start with magnet school transfers. So parents can go online and they can apply for their magnet school transfers beginning on April 1st. So I just wanted to share that with the public tonight as well as the board. Thank you.
Okay. Last comment. Again, I'd like to say congratulations and good luck to our basketball girls. Also, I'd like to say thank you again to O.W. Dillon and Mr. Titus Showers for coming out and performing for us tonight, and to all of our Tangipahoa Parish schools that took part in the celebration of the Black History Month. Throughout the month of February, because I know that up until today, you still had some schools who were celebrating, and at Kenwood High School, I was there today, and they were doing their program. So we want to say thank you, because we want all of our children to feel important and recognized. The other thing is, please continue your support for the Village of Tangipahoa. They are still dislocated. We thank you for all that you're bringing in and helping with that little village, because we have the parish is there, and they're, I mean, demolishing homes and tearing them completely down. So our families they just don't have anywhere to go, and they're in need of everything. So, and from my understanding, we're not receiving that much of federal funding coming in. So whatever it is that we can do would be a help. On the lighter side of things.
Is there a GoFundMe or something set up for that?
No, they hadn't set a GoFundMe. But, okay. But I do know that we have about 40 parents that are homes that were completely demolished. And because a lot of them, it was a trailer park, so it was a lot of them were trailers, and it just kind of just took over it, and along with the store and the church that was there, is one of the churches is completely gone. So also on a lighter note, I'm excited we have one of our own again from Kentwood High School, that Trey Palmer. He was invited to the NFL Combine that's going to be this weekend in Indianapolis, and definitely I will be there. So I'm excited about that. I got invited to go with his family, so definitely I will be going to that. And so we're excited about that. Okay. The last thing is we need to announce that the March 7th, 2023 board meeting has been canceled, and the next regular scheduled meeting will be held on Tuesday, March 21st. Okay, right now at 6:00. Okay, if there's nothing else, thank you all. Meeting is adjourned.